Farah, welcome to Let the Quran Speak.
Thank you so much for having me today.
When people think of sleep disorders, I think they often think of, you know, insomnia, perhaps, or sleepwalking, or sleep apnea. But there are many other sleep disorders, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. I think certain ones we tend to be more familiar with, like you mentioned. In reality, there's kind of upwards of about 80 sleep disorders. So there are certainly ones that we don't hear as much about. For me in particular, you know, I talk a lot about narcolepsy and idiopathic hypersomnia. But again, there are countless others and lots of different types of symptoms and kind of conditions.
Mm-hmm. So how do you tell if you have a sleep disorder? Because, you know, these days, a lot of people have issues with sleep, right?
Yeah.
You know, they don't get enough hours of sleep, perhaps. They can't sleep. They feel tired during the day. So at what point does it become an issue where you go to the doctor?
Right. Yeah. And, you know, I think exactly like you said, we're kind of in a sort of a sleep deprived culture.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of the hustle culture feeds into that, right? So it absolutely can be difficult to tell. You know, like I mentioned, there are so many different types of disorders that they all look different, right? So for some people, depending on the, you know, the disorder, it could be things like having difficulty falling asleep or staying asleep. Sometimes it's falling asleep at inappropriate times, unusual behaviors during sleep. You know, so those are potentially things to look out for. But the other thing too is that, you know, the kind of day to day, we do have, you know, a few days that are off and then usually it kind of resets.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's more, you know, if you're seeing it on a consistent basis, right? So whatever that particular challenge is, if it's happening repeatedly, that's when, you know, it's definitely worth having a chat with your doctor.
Mm-hmm. You were diagnosed with a sleep disorder. Tell me about that.
Yeah, absolutely. So the condition that I have is idiopathic hypersomnia. So if we break that down, hypersomnia is excessive sleepiness. Idiopathic just means we don't know why.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, that's kind of the diagnosis I have. I also have certain symptoms of a disorder called narcolepsy, which is another one that not too many people are familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the kind of excessive sleepiness or excessive daytime sleepiness in particular, are kind of the big symptoms that we see. But there are a lot of invisible elements as well, things that, you know, sometimes get lost in the media portrayals that are kind of funny and people falling asleep in their soup.
Mm-hmm.
That's not what that looks like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes it's this really intense desire to sleep, but it doesn't mean you're just passing out all of a sudden.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with narcolepsy, there are also symptoms like hallucinations related to sleep, something called cataplexy, where there's a loss of muscle tone when there's kind of intense emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And so again,
has that ever happened to you?
I have had, you know, kind of certain experiences, even within that one symptom, mm-hmm. people experience it differently.
Okay.
So for some people, you know, and laughter is often the thing that will trigger it, but other strong emotions like anger or sadness. But, you know, for some people, it's just like a slackening of the jaw, buckling of the knees. For other people, they fall right to the ground.
Mm.
So even just that one symptom, mm-hmm. huge range of how it can look for different people. So for me, I have had a few, but it's been, you know, very mild for me.
So how'd you discover that you had this?
Oh,
must have been a long process to get diagnosed, right?
Yeah. And, you know, you touch on such an important point. There is a shocking delay between the onset of symptoms and the diagnosis. So for something like narcolepsy, it's usually 8 to 15 years that people go.
Whoa. I thought you would say like eight to 15 months. And I was thinking that's long.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really a surprising thing. A huge part of people's lives go without knowing. A lot of people don't even get diagnosed.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, when I kind of look back, I suspect I had symptoms right from maybe the age of 5 when I was in kindergarten. It wasn't kind of until university. I was studying for the MCAT, wanting to be, you know, going into medicine, and I started to see more and more symptoms appear. And, you know, for me, again, it's looking at, is it happening all the time, right? Because a few times we'll write things off. We'll say that's kind of a weird thing that happened, but it's persistent. And that's kind of when I clued in and said, okay, I don't know what's going on, but I need to see a doctor about it.
Mm-hmm. And then what was the process that you went through in order to get diagnosed?
Yeah, great question. So for me, it kind of started by going to a family doctor. And then getting kind of some sleep studies done. So I connected with a sleep specialist. And, you know, there's kind of a bit of a waiting period, you know, waiting for the sleep study to happen. Eventually, it led to, for me, getting treatment through medication, and also kind of learning how to adjust certain lifestyle factors as well.
So how does this affect your life, Farah? Like, you have idiopathic hypersomnia, and I understand narcolepsy as well. What does that do for you?
Yeah. And so just to clarify, you know, you'll have one condition. So again, for me, it's idiopathic hypersomnia, but there is, you know, kind of this gray area. And I think, you know, a lot of people sometimes get caught in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of kind of what life looks like, it involves certain adjustments. I think the empowering thing has, you know, been to do all the things that I still want to do. And, you know, alhamdulillah, going off to grad school was a big part of that for me. But it's tweaking the way you do things, right? So learning to take naps and at the right time, adjusting kind of the way I study, being aware of my capacity, and also just being honest, having those conversations with supervisors and, you know, bosses, and just kind of explaining what that looks like for me and making those adjustments was really critical.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What advice would you have for somebody who thinks they might have a sleep disorder?
Yeah. So, you know, first of all, I think seeing a doctor, that's so important. I think, you know, especially with so much access to information, it can be tempting to go look up a lot of things. I'm guilty. I've done it. Dr. Google, right?
We've all done it.
We've all done it, right? And so, you know, it can lead to us sort of looking at symptoms online and trying to self-diagnose, right? So I think it's really important to seek, you know, medical professional advice there.
Mm-hmm. What about people around somebody who's suffering, right? How would you, what advice would you have for them?
Yeah.
Because sometimes they will think, for example, that a person is lazy, right?
Right.
Or they don't want to do the work, or they're bored or something like that because they have this sleep disorder.
Right. Yeah. You know, there's an incredible amount of stigma around sleep disorders. And again, I think a lot of it is just these invisible elements that we don't see, right? So exactly like you said, thinking someone's lazy, you know, a lot of the time it's, oh, you're in school, you don't really want to, you know, you're bored with learning that stuff.
I'm sure you experienced some of this yourself.
Absolutely, right? And it's a serious condition, right? It is important to address those things. And so, you know, when it comes to loved ones, I think so much of it is just learning. You know, obviously knowledge is power and it's empowering as well. And I think that's so important. You know, I think as a loved one, there can be an incredible amount of pressure to support, mm-hmm. to feel like you have to find the answer. And really so much of the support just comes from trying to learn about it and understand what it is, right? One in five people are estimated to have a sleep disorder of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge number, right? It's not rare. It's not uncommon. And so again, just learning, you know, and being aware that could be anybody, could be you, could be a loved one.
I know you do work with Project Sleep. Tell us about that.
Yeah. So I'm very excited. I am part of the Rising Voices of Narcolepsy speaking program. So the goal with that program, and it's kind of a project run through Project Sleep, is really to kind of empower patients to use their stories to just raise awareness and help people to kind of learn about these disorders. Like you mentioned earlier, some sleep disorders we hear about a lot,
mm-hmm.
But other ones, you know, really aren't heard about as much. And even narcolepsy, right? People think that might be rare. One in 2,000 people, roughly, right? Mm-hmm. That's about 19,000 Canadians who might be experiencing narcolepsy, right?
Farah, thank you so much for sharing your story with us and your advice regarding sleep disorders.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
If you enjoyed this video, click like and subscribe. And please donate to support our work at QuranSpeaks.com.